And we move on to our next session, being the other. Farahnaz Ispahani, Nandini Krishnan, and Nazia Erum will be in conversation with Kalpana Sharma. Farahnaz is a global fellow at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars. Nandini Krishnan is a writer, dancer, and stage actor. Nazia is the author of the critically acclaimed book, Mothering a Muslim. Kalpana Sharma is an independent journalist, author, and now reader's editor at scroll.in.
Hello, everyone. Good morning or good afternoon. So we have an interesting panel here today. And for me as the moderator, it's a particular challenge because I have three people here, each of whom have written a very distinct and different book. And each of these books actually require a one-hour discussion because they cover really unusual topics. But we are on the same panel and our subject is being the other. So what we are going to try and do is bring out from the three separate books that the three authors have written the common themes that have come out. And as I can see it, Farahnaz here has written on Pakistan, and it's really a fascinating book, Purifying the Land of the Pure, which, at least for me, I followed events in Pakistan, but this is the first book that I've read that has really focused on the whole issue of a minority within an overwhelming majority and how that becomes a political issue and sustains itself over 70 years, which is quite extraordinary. And we will hear from her. Nandini has written about, even within sexual minorities, another minority. So whereas in the trans, now that we've all come to recognize LGBTQ and the fact that there are the sexualities and there is not just the binary between male and female, which many of us from my generation grew up believing. Even within that, trans men is something that is hardly written about, whereas now much more is written about trans women. And that has been the focus of her book. And Nazia's book is a very interesting one because it's about mothering a Muslim. And she has talked on the whole issue of how children these days are beginning to actually have their identity thrust on them by a variety of things. And so my question to all three of you will be one that I hope you can address, which is that, you know, all societies have the other. It's not, I mean, no society is homogenous. There can never be a society where everybody is the same, obviously. But the trend that we're seeing around the world, and now especially in the subcontinent, and because we have Farahnaz here from Pakistan and we are in India, I think the growing trend of this inability to tolerate a difference, to tolerate somebody who is different from you in terms of their sexual orientation, in terms of their religion, in terms of caste in this country, and the fact that that brings out not a desire to try and understand, but the contrary. It brings out the desire almost to eliminate difference, which regardless of our particular politics in our countries, that seems to be the overwhelming trend. So in that, how do you see, how do you understand this thing of the other? And I'll start with you, Farahnaz, because I think in Pakistan, that is something that we know not enough about, or if we do read about it sporadically, we don't get the context, you know? So I think it'd be very useful to know from you, why is it in Pakistan, when it's a country that was set up as an Islamic country, has an overwhelming population who belong to the same religion, and yet even within that religion, there are problems apart from people who do not belong to that religion. And that minority is only 3%, as you point out. So maybe you could start and then I'll ask the other.
Hi, good morning. Can everyone hear me? I have a soft voice. The book that I've written, which is part of this conversation here today, is I've written a book on Pakistan's religious minorities, both Muslim and non-Muslim. And there's a reason why I've talked about the Muslim as well as the non-Muslim. In a way, Pakistan had to get to where it is today. As someone born and bred in Pakistan, with both my father and mother's families having come from this side of the border, from the very beginning, when the constitution was first tampered with, and it said, the Pakistani constitution, that all citizens of Pakistan are equal, but Islam is the state language. So therefore, you immediately negated the equality of everyone who wasn't a Muslim. After that, you have these different stages. The first cleansing, which happened on both sides, but on the Pakistani side, the first cleansing was of the Hindus. There was a partition cleansing, and it continued throughout Pakistan. And now today in erstwhile East Pakistan, Bangladesh, you're seeing the cleansing of Hindus. After that, you move into Muslim minorities like the Ahmadis. Ahmadi Muslims are considered Muslims in India. They're considered Muslims all over the world. In Pakistan, the constitution and parliament declared them non-Muslim. So here's a different thing. These are not people you escaped from in India where you were scared of the majority. Suddenly you've taken one group of Muslims and said, hey, you're not Muslim enough for us. Then you go on to the Christians. Then you go on to the Shias, who are now, by many schools of Islamic thought in Pakistan, are considered kafirs, non-believers, and therefore often punishable by death. So we have these four stages: Muslimization, which is a massive decline in Hindu and Sikh populations from 47 to 58. Islamic identity, where the state-sponsored textbooks rejecting pluralism, which was from 58 to 71. Islamization, which is where the legislation against minorities became serious, between 74 and 88. And finally, the stage which still exists today, militant hostility, terrorism and organized violence. So from Lashkar-e-Taiba, from the SSP and Shia, anti-Shia groups, from all of these groups from 88 to present day. So we have been living in Pakistan since 88 in militant hostility. Fast forward, we're living in a world here today where from the United States to India, the world's largest democracy and the world's greatest democracy, as both of you call yourselves, are now have populist leaders who have made it okay to espouse hatred towards the other. And the other in India, starting with, because I write on religion, to begin with are the Muslim and Christian populations of this country. In the United States, it's largely anti-Semitism towards Jews and Islamophobia against Muslims. But what the terrifying thing is, when I wrote my book, I did not even think, just a few years ago, that I would be sitting in India today and saying to you, my God, we actually carved out a country. We took 70 years to get to this level of hatred. And here, and in the United States, and in Hungary, and all over Europe, and Indonesia, all these pluralistic societies, you're following in our paths, man. What is going on? And why is there not more pushback? So that's how I think I'll just leave it for here, and we thank you.
Thank you. I think, reading your book, I was really, it really creeped me out because there were bits of it and you just changed the names of the community and the country. And We are seeing it happening here. Exactly the same thing. And as you say, it's taken you 70 years to reach this point, and we are really fast forwarding to the point where we'll be there tomorrow, you know, if things don't change. And I think the combination of the textbooks that you talk about and the kind of, you know, teaching children literally, you know, to hate the other and to have intolerance of the other, all this is beginning to happen here with erasure of parts of our history which are there. So you have generations of kids who will grow up without even knowing about it. So I'd like to take this then to Nazia, because I think what you have brought out in your book is really what has happened in the last few years. And how do you understand it as not just a mother of a young child, but as somebody who's done this research by talking to both teachers and students and seeing the manner in which this trend has escalated? I mean, it's not as if it was not there. As we were discussing earlier, I come from Mumbai, where certainly after the demolition of the Babri Masjid and the 92-93 riots, we saw very clearly that, you know, first of all, the facade of cosmopolitanism was ripped apart. And then when you scratch the surface, the real identity, what people actually thought of the other, came out. And it was very soon not even politically incorrect to say these things. Now, of course, it's blatant, but then people maybe hesitated still, but now it's openly so. And the other thing I think to also consider is, you know, even though, say, amongst the poor, there is no problem with the other. You know, you live together in a city like Bombay, against the urban poor, share common problems of being denial of basic facilities. And they'll always refer to their neighbor as, wo Musalman, wo Bihari, wo UP wala, wo Madrasi, etc., you know. But it doesn't necessarily have hostility in it. But I think, again, 92-93 shattered that too. And there was hostility towards the other, which had been brought in by the larger politics. So it would be really interesting to know from you how you analyze what you put forward in your book. What are the factors that have led to the escalation of the other, which has always been there in India's history, but it's reached a point where even young kids now are talking about it, and as you've described, that there's even you know, a physical expression of hostility towards the other.
Right. You know, picking up from where Farahnaz left it, I guess next time somebody says that, go to Pakistan, I should say that we are becoming one. So, you know, right, it was always there, the knowledge of being an other. But somehow it was not put forward with that kind of an anger, that kind of hatred, that kind of almost feeling like an orphan in your own country. You know, I traveled to like 12 cities, spoke to 200 plus mothers, and I remember this lady from Bhopal who tells me while she was growing up, so she is in her late 40s now. So when she was growing up, so say when she was 5, that's 40 years back, her parents had moved to a new neighborhood within Bhopal. And so she was out at the little lawn that they had, you know, having, you know, hopping around while her parents were unpacking inside. And a neighbor peeps in and starts having a conversation with her. So, and after a while, the neighbor says, oh, tu Musalman ho, you're a Muslim. And the girl is offended. She's like, tum ho gaye Musalman, main to Asma hu. I am Asma, I'm not Musalman. So that is the India we grew up in. Not knowing these compartmentalizations of Hindu, Muslim. I have a 5-year-old. I have not yet told her that you are a Muslim, your best friend is a Sikh, and your teacher is a Hindu. I have not done that. And that, I believe all of us believe, is how we are bringing up our children and how we think India is. But that is denial of what's happening out there. We think, you know, it's on TV. It's 24/7 on TV. It's somebody else. It's in your political rallies. It's only politics, you know, it's not affecting us. But it is. Today, in the best of schools, and I underline best of schools to tell you this is not somebody else. This is not the fringe. This is your house, my house, the schools that our children go to. Where conversations of 5-year-olds of kindergarten go something like this. Are you a Muslim?
The child says, yes, but I don't eat beef. So children not only know that they are Muslim or Hindu, that the child sitting next to them is a Muslim or Hindu, but they also know that they need an explanation along with the fact that they are Muslims. And this is when things are still non-violent. Many other conversations end up with violence, which says that I hate Hindus, and the child starts, I hate Muslims, and they start hitting each other. So yes, are we becoming Pakistan? Do we want to become Pakistan? Do we want to keep our blinkers on and not accept this as something that's kind of entered every home, entered every conversation? When you ask me why, how do kids pick this up? Parents are appalled. They say, this is not what I told my child. I don't know from where my child picked this up. And the only answer is that it's in the air. It's the narrative that has formed around us. It's the narrative that is very fast engulfing us. And I keep saying this, hatred, it will not look at your religion when it picks on your children. It will not differentiate between a Hindu, Sikh, Isai. It will pick each and every child up and swallow them, their childhood up, and the future of India. So how does this happen? How does othering reach this level? Because we don't like having difficult conversations as a nation. We don't like talking about sex. Shh, put it under the carpet. Homophobia. You wrote a brilliant book on that. And we don't want to have these conversations. We don't want to have those difficult conversations of Islamophobia. Till now was a Western concept. It was not happening in India. Hello, we grew up with those, if you remember going back to our DD days when, we'll have those songs from every part of India, everybody singing Vande Mataram together and, Ek Chiriya, Anek Chiriya. How many of you remember those? We loved those. We grew up on that. But we don't have that narrative around our children today. Today our children are hearing speeches which talk about Ram, Rahim, and which tries to pull us apart. And I think it kind of also comes from the fact that why is it so easy to pull us apart? Is it also because I'm throwing this up for everyone? Is it also because the fact that we are every day trained to fight for our bread and butter, that every day we are scared somebody will come and take it away. So it's it kind of intrinsic in us to pick on differences. Maybe in a parallel universe where there's no religion, people will start, picking up on, oh, she wears pink, I don't like her. We start hating each other on the colors or something else. Because I think it's kind of when you don't have that social security to fall back on, I think we are looking to fight, to find those differences to fight on. I think we need to recognize that. And, research says that best organizations are those that have a lot of diversity in them, because you learn from each other. You are enriched by each other's differences. You're supposed to be enriched by those different lived experiences and learnings. But unfortunately, today we are fighting on those differences.
Thank you. I think this question of why, we'll take it up because, not everybody is fighting for their bread and butter. And yet, in fact, it's those who are not fighting for bread and butter are the ones who are perpetuating the wrong. And I think it's also, it's a human instinct. If you have somebody who you can demean, you feel better about yourself. And I think when that goes along with the politics that dominates in a country, where your self-affirmation is based on demeaning and othering or excluding another group, or that I think is a problem. And that percolates into everything. It percolates in our media. In our media, not only in the manner in which certain things are reported, but the manner in which certain things are excluded. So you erase entire communities. You don't hear their voices. You think that something that's happening only is happening to a particular class or a caste or a group, and not actually to a lot of people. I mean, here in this panel, we are not even talking about the Dalit issue. But that is a huge thing in India. In 70 years, we still haven't confronted it. But let me then, before we get into the why, which I think is a very important part, ask Nandini, because now you have touched on another othering, which in a way, you know, touches even a more basic instinct. It has nothing to do with religion. I mean, I can be a Muslim or a Jain or whatever, but there is some kind of, in India, I suppose everywhere, this kind of inability to get our heads around the fact that, you know, because of sexual orientation, there are people who are different, who have, and who have the right to make a different choice. So maybe you can tell us on trans men in your research, what you found and the kind of issues that they confronted in dealing with their own choice that they wanted to make, and with the society around them, which looked at them askance because they were making these choices. And then maybe you can touch on, you know, Nandini has been trolled for her book for on two points. One, that who is she to write about trans men, because she's not trans, which is an old debate that takes place on a lot of issues that writers choose to write on. If they're not part of that particular thing, if they don't identify, then, you know, it's seen as exploitation. You're doing it to make money. And the second thing is because you've quoted from Hindu scriptures, so you're seen as saffron. And
Hindu
you're
trying mythology, I
mythology,
would say. Yeah.
Mythology, and therefore you've got the saffron chap on you.
So, which would have made my job a lot easier if I were, if someone asked if my book was sponsored by the BJP or RSS, and then I said my budgeting would have been a lot easier if it had in 2018. But no, I think your question makes me think of, there are three kinds of othering, you know, one, which all of which Farahnaz also touched on. One is the othering of a minority by the majority. The other is the othering within the minority itself of other minorities, or an othering within the majority, which would be maybe in India caste, and also an othering from a marginalized community on the majority, which is what right do you have to speak about us or to speak for us. And so I'll come to each of these, but when we speak of an othering by a majority on a minority, I think that's when you said it doesn't have to do with religion, but I think several tools can be used for the othering. Religion can be used by saying being transgender or being homosexual is anti-Christianity or anti-Islam. Culture can be used, because Hinduism, as people are very fond of saying, is a way of life, not a religion. So then you can say, oh, now you're westernized, and you know this is against Indian culture or against Bangladeshi culture or Pakistani culture or whichever, Arabian culture. So there are various ways of using tools in order to marginalize a minority. Now, within a minority itself, so one of my interviewees, a trans man, was telling me that, you know, this whole thing of gender, now you have a male, female, transgender, or intersex, biologically male, female, intersex. And then with gender on your identification forms, you have male, female, transgender. And so this person said, and this person doesn't use a pronoun, so S, not even they, S is the pronoun I use, because S's name was Sunil. And Sunil was saying, so you make three categories, and from that, people will fall out, because there are people like myself who don't identify as any of those three. So within these three, you make 10 categories, and then again, people will fall out of that. So within trans men, you could have preoperative, postoperative, non-operative, gender non-conforming, non-binary identifying, assigned female at birth, whatever, and people will still fall out of those categories. So there is an othering at every single step. For as long as we have categories, we have othering. And then what you spoke about, the trolling that I faced, is when you're assigned a label and termed a majority, and either you could be elitist, or you could be saffron, or you could be whatever. Like, once you're given a label, and we were speaking yesterday about, you know, when someone is labeled, for instance, a Savarna feminist, what can you say? Because then everything you say becomes invalidated, because you as a human being are only your label. So my book, of course, was burnt in Manipur, because they said that I was imposing a mainstream Hindu reading on Manipuris and they have their own indigenous culture. Whereas I was looking at mythology, which was Greek, Nordic, Icelandic, Hindu, maybe even from the DC universe, depending on whether you want to see Thor as Nordic or DC. But so I was looking at mythology in the context that not that these were given to us by the gods, like, you know, food packets thrown down by rescue helicopters or whatever, but then as myths that people were making. And that is relevant because whenever these myths were made, it gives you a lot of insight into how people thought at that time. So if gender was so fluid in so many of our ancient mythologies, including Egyptian, what does it say about what the perception of gender was so long ago? Because Native American languages have 5 genders. How did all of that come down to 2? And now why are we arguing about a third? So that was my point. But then it's very easy to say that, oh, you're with the Hindutva movement, or to say you're elitist, or to say you're a cis woman and therefore you have no right to talk about us. So I think there's various kinds of othering. And all of these categories become tools through which you can other somebody. And labels become tools through which you can other somebody.
I think you gave a great explanation. I'm just going to add something to you. Look, when I wrote my book, I was by the Pakistani military establishment, etc. I was called a traitor. I was called a traitor, even though this book was based on fact. I made it a big point not to base it on my own things I had seen in real life, Christian villages being burnt to the ground, people's dead bodies in morgues, things I'd seen as a politician and a parliamentarian. So I rooted the book in history, but I became a ghaddar. I became a traitor to Pakistan for portraying not just a wrong, but a negative image of Pakistan. So the point is for all of us, you know what? It doesn't matter what they call us. What matters is putting one foot in front of the other and keep moving straight to the tune of your drummer, because you are answering to yourself, a God if you believe in one, or your moral compass. That's it. That's the only way.
I mean, in an ideal world, yes, Farahnaz, that is the way it ought to be. But I think as we've said that, you know, I think this thing of labeling in societies where we call ourselves democratic and therefore there is space for that, it's fine. But when that gets thwarted, when it gets diluted, when it gets undermined by political power that endorses people taking the law into their own hands and therefore the other cannot actually operate. So whether you're a writer or a speaker or just, you know, an ordinary person who's going about their job, when that is the atmosphere that prevails in our countries, then it becomes, you know, it's not then just doing what we want to do, because you're doing it within a political context. And so even logic, of course, does not prevail in that case. So the question that you asked about why, for instance, why is this happening? I think that is something that, in a way, each of us comes at it from a different point. But I think we have to really consider what has happened in India, especially, given that we've had various points at which the markers of what made India different from, say, Pakistan, have been pulled down slowly and gradually, and then they've escalated now. But it has not happened suddenly. It has been a process over time. And I think, as we were discussing earlier, it's something that not just the politics, but everybody has played a part in it. All of us, and I say this as a person from the media, certainly the media has contributed to the fact that this kind of inability to accept that there are people who think differently, who are different, who believe in something different, and that all of us have a space within our societies, I think that is what we have to question, that is this inevitable in our countries now, given the trend globally? If not, what is the thing that has to be done to reverse it, you know, and to some extent, so that people can survive, literally. I mean, it's become a question of not just toleration, but in India and Pakistan, it's actually a question, and Bangladesh, of physical survival. So I think this is what I'd like to know. And I'm sure the trans people are also confronting this kind of physical intimidation and violence that maybe earlier people would just turn their heads away. And now it's not so anymore. There's an aggression now to this non-acceptance of the other.
I think, yes, it's definitely not always been there. Like, I remember while growing up, 90s, Hamas was the leading militant outfit there. Today, kids might not even know what Hamas is. And I remember in the winters, my brother would tie a muffler on his face. And a friend had, you know, then come up to him and said, "Yaar, tu to Hamas lag raha." But it was done with a lot of, you know, jest in the voice, with a lot of a hand on the shoulder. Today, aggression is the keyword. And you can almost see the pre-2014 and post-2014, the aggression that has come in this. So while, yes, it was always there, we can see the sharp rise post-2014. And also the fact that it's, you know, prejudices and stereotypes that we call, you know, that might be true, might not be true, today are seen as facts. So as I was telling you earlier, that today my maids reject me. You know, they would stand in my house and say, "Aapke ghar to beef hi banta hoga, because you're a Muslim. You have to be cooking beef." Beef, by the way, is banned up north. And for me, Dadri is 20 kilometers away from my house where the first lynching happened. When somebody like that stands in my own house and says that, it's clear and present danger for me. It's very scary to even hear that being said out loud in so many words. You know, bread and butter doesn't need to be taken literally. Bread and butter is the same for politicians. They are power is their is they might be doing it for power, but that's their bread and butter. So it's important to realize that while there has been a sharp rise, people have started believing this untruth that is being peddled out as facts, because they have been repeated so much. They're repeated on a daily basis. They're repeated from 10 different sources. So it's very difficult. How do you fight this? How do you fight this?
Oh, yeah. You had asked me just before Nazia spoke about how trans people might have turned the other way, and now there's an aggression. Now, I think, I don't know if it's true of trans people, as in cis people hating on trans people or whatever, but then I think a lot of aggression across communities has happened because of social media, because it allows you to publish things anonymously for one and without information for another. You know, maybe 30 years back, you needed access and information and validation in order to put your words out there, to put your ideas out there. Now you're published, you could be retweeted, you could go viral, saying the most inane, uninformed thing. You can burn a book without reading it. Because I don't think you can be offended by anything once you have seen it and contemplated to the extent that you want it not to have been there. Because if you're open to it, you'd like a conversation to happen around it. But as long as you've closed it and said, "Oh, that film should not be screened at the theater, that book should not be read, that person should not live here, that community should not be tolerated," you have closed your mind to it. And what gives you the power to do that is that you can find strength in numbers without even knowing who your allies are, because social media allows you to be anonymous. And I think that's one of the big dangers in India, because one thing I've noticed with, let's say, Twitter is that in Pakistan, for instance, you do have the rabid rabble-rousers, but then you also have a lot of intellectuals on Twitter, a lot of open-minded people who constantly fight. In India, there's a very, very, very large and a very quick growing population of fundamentalists, by which I mean of saffron extremists. An organized one, very well informed, sorry, very savvy with technology, very quick to tweet, clever to make sure that there are small differences so that their tweets don't sound all alike, and assuming various names, very quickly
Let's
putting
call
things...
call it what it is, it's a paid troll army.
Very quickly putting things out there and harassing people, and at some point, because the numbers are so large, one stops engaging. You know, so I think that's a big danger, and how do we fight it? I don't know how we fight. How do we fight fake news? How do we fight WhatsApp forwards going forward and saying, you know, that, oh, these people are killing someone. Oh, this person has beef in his store. Oh, this person is, there are North Indians coming here to kidnap children. And there were lynchings across Tamil Nadu a few months ago because there was a WhatsApp forward going around saying a group of North Indians were kidnapping children and offering them chocolates to lure them away. And people were killed. 30 odd people were attacked and 7 died. So how do we stop it? I don't know.
Actually, I have a question for you based on this. Given that, you know, this, it's very political, this attack on the Ahmadis and the Shias, and then the other religious minorities. How, I mean, here what Nazia is saying and, you know, what I've experienced in Mumbai is that it has actually come down to ordinary people's attitudes also. Now in Pakistan, given that, you know, this is such a small minority, do you find like amongst Pakistanis, because the overwhelming majority are Muslim, is there a growing intolerance of some, I mean, Ahmadis would be have been considered Muslim earlier and now are not. How does it translate itself in the day-to-day discourse in Pakistan, you know?
I think it's so difficult in India. I realize you think you're having a very hard time on Twitter, but in Pakistan, journalists get picked up. They disappeared. They end up in jails with the intelligence services, in jail cells for terrorists. So what I'm saying here is, you know, you may think your space is shrinking. It is. And I'm telling you right now, you have to fight. But you have to fight politically. The only way to win, in the United States right now, we went out and fought those midterms. We put in every penny for every candidate. We brought in 100 women into the House of Representatives. Yellow, blue, green, every religion under the sun. That's the way you do it. Because all power is ultimately political power. But for example, what you're saying, let me just kind of explain to you what it means to be an Ahmadi. If an Ahmadi is found with a copy of the Quran Sharif, they go to jail. If an Ahmadi calls his mosque a masjid, he goes to jail. If an Ahmadi, non-mosque, house of worship, gives the Muslim call to prayer, the azan, he goes to jail. If an Ahmadi writes La ilaha illallah or any verses from the Quran Sharif on his or a tombstone of a family member, the police will go and with hammers and whatever and chip away those words. That is what hatred, annihilation of the other means. You don't exist. You do not exist.
But would non-Ahmadis earlier, who would not have had this kind of, the fact of this action, suppose I'm not an Ahmadi, I'm a Muslim and a Sunni, would my hatred of the Ahmadis have increased because of these actions, or in our day-to-day transactions, that doesn't happen? That's what I'm asking.
Society changes. Look, all human beings have some racism in them. All human beings grow up with some cultural norms or biases towards another, maybe ethnicity, another religious group, someone of a different caste, creed, color. We're humans. We're not gods. We're humans. Those things exist in all of us. But the moment you give political sanction, you give political sanction, that to the entire country makes it okay. It's suddenly okay. And that is what is happening. So today in Pakistan, now within the Sunni communities, the Deobandi Sunnis and the Barelvi Sunnis are out battling each other to the end. And this is what I call purification. You start purifying all your minorities out. At the end, if it, in India, it comes down to the Hindus. In America, if it comes down to the Christians, the evangelicals and the Catholics will be burning each other's churches, will be killing each other at prayer. So understand what purification means. It means annihilate that other because they are stain on humanity. They are stain on our lives. And it's hard for people like us who are not naturally like that to understand how these people can feel like that about others. But that's what I was saying. When people tell you, you should not have written this book, you should say, someone had to write it. And I was the first person in India to do the book. You know?
So, I mean, that's...
I get what you're saying, but the important thing to remember is that I'm not the other here. It's a very, very small... I get what you're saying, but I'm saying in... I'm writing about the other, but when I spoke about a minority othering a majority, say putting a label on you and saying, I mean, someone in Pakistan could say, oh, you're elitist, you're English educated, and therefore you have the power and connections or whatever to write this thing on us, and what right do you have to say it? You know, so once they put a label on you, that invalidates it. But then when we speak about othering in that sense, I mean, I think this is a little, this wouldn't have too much connection to either of your books, but the trans bill was taken up in the Rajya Sabha on the 8th, as it came up for hearing and then it was adjourned and all of that. But that bill, there's been a huge controversy about it because in making the bill, they didn't listen to any of the parties who would be affected. Yeah. So for as long, you can't have a conversation when the power structures are arranged such that the final decision lies with somebody who's not a stakeholder. And that's how all power structures are organized. The stakeholders, the people who are affected, are not in power. And
the triple talaq bill also.
And so even with the citizenship bill, which was passed recently, so the stakeholders have no say in it. Someone else is making the decision on your behalf. So I think that's the whole problem with othering. For as long as you aren't giving power to people who would actually be allowed to come out of the other, while making legislation on their lives, how can you stop othering them? Like, I mean, if an Ahmadi cannot even be a citizen of Pakistan, because right now I think in the passport there is not a single religion that they can mark. So you can't be a citizen of Pakistan. How do you rise to a place where you have the power to change that legislation?
That's where I think it's a very elitist idea that you have to belong to a community to do it. Why should I have to be, if the Ahmadis cannot speak for themselves, that's my job. That is my job. In parliament, people who were like-minded, we were from all different parties. We used to pool our minutes together and give the highest ranking person who was the best speaker, our time, so that person would have 10 minutes on the floor speaking for the Ahmadis or the Shia Hazaras or Asia Bibi or whatever the issue of the day was, or against the Taliban or the Lashkar-e-Taiba, whatever it was. So I really find this a very elitist idea that unless you belong to a community, you cannot understand the issues, you cannot feel about it. Whoever is sitting in a position of doing something, do it. Do it. It may not be perfect, but you're doing it.
I think that's one thing I just want to say, which has sort of come out, is that I think it's out of the silence of those who know what is happening is wrong that this kind of thing gets perpetuated. And I think, you know, in India, those who came out once the lynching started and started this movement of Not in My Name, and protested about it. That has to escalate much more. Because I think the silence of the majority, who may not endorse those actions, but at the same time don't speak out, aren't proactive in saying that this is not the kind of India we want, this is not what we support. If they turn the other way, that is when actually that the people
silence
who are powerful.
Silence is complicity today. You are complicit to the entire, whatever is happening out there, if you're silent and if you're allowing that to happen. Silence today is complicity. And as I keep saying, that don't think it's somebody else. Don't think it, don't put it on the fringe. It's on your shoulders and the onus is yours.
Okay, shall we just open it up to the audience? Because I'm sure people have questions. As I said, we have three people who have done very different books and who brought different perspectives to this discussion. So please ask a question of any of them or a general question which any of them can answer. Don't make it a long-winded question so that we have enough time for questions. Yeah.
My question is for Nazia. I'm interested to know how you're teaching your child to deal with this.
How am I teaching my child to?
To deal with this othering.
That actually was the question why I started doing the book. That's why I set on this journey to talk to my counterparts to understand how do I deal with this. I have not yet told my child, as I said, that you are Hindu or you're Muslim or you're Sikh, you're Isai. I've not compartmentalized in her head her religion. She knows how to perform the namaz. She knows about Allah. But Muslim as an identification marker on her, I have not. In fact, when I had my child in 2014, when I first held my baby in my arms, that is when I felt this. If you go back to 2014 and the kind of narrative that was building at that point, we were in the middle of our national elections in February. So, I was very fearful of giving her a Muslim-sounding name. It comes from a position of weakness. I'm not saying it comes from a position of strength. I gave her a neutral-sounding name because I have seen, in our apartment complex, when you're in the lift and there's a visibly Muslim person out there, people take a step back. I've seen that happening. I wanted her to have a normal childhood. So in the midst of all these places that make you so take a step back. You're not on your best foot forward. How do you deal with this? How do you tell a child that it's just another child? And how do you? In fact, I remember when Padmavati just came out, Padmavat just came out earlier this year, earlier 2018. A friend of mine who has a 7-year-old and who again brings up a child in a similar way, when they were out in the theater watching the movie. And Khilji comes on stage and he's all this, how Khilji was, aggressive and, eating, reading or flesh with his hands and all that. So, and the child says, Mama, is that a Muslim? Because he looks very violent. And the child is a Muslim. And the mother did not know how to tell the child that you are what you fear. So the book, in fact, starts with a similar story of a child hiding in the backseat of a car because she can see Muslims all around her who are coming out from namaz. And she's like, Muslims are going to come and kill us. So there's a lot of internalization of the fear. So how do you ask a child to deal with this? I remember a mother who told me that when a child came back to her from school and told that I was bullied today and, I was called a Pakistani and I was asked to go to Pakistan. So the mother sat her child down and she said that, it's okay to be a Pakistani, but you are not a Pakistani. So I think we need to, have that little bit of sensitivity the way we handle it. Also, we need to make sure that we address it then and there. Don't shun away from having that difficult conversation with no matter how young your child is. Today the children are very, they're very fast. You think the children at 5, they don't know how to differentiate. But young kids today are like, if you come from a very well-to-do family, you're a Pakistani. If you don't come from a well-to-do family, you're a Bangladeshi. So that the kids are that quick, then let's not underestimate them.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Even without seeing the other side, many Indians have preconceived notions about Pakistan. Like, this is due to the invisible hatred that is passed on from generation to generation. So how can this serious issue be overcome?
That's for Farahnaz.
I'm sorry, you were saying that there's a conception. Go ahead.
Even without seeing the other side, many Indians, they have preconceived notions about Pakistan. Like, this is due to, the main reason is, like, there's an invisible hatred being passed on from generation to generation. So this is a very serious issue. How can this be overcome?
Well, I think some of these things are based in reality. India and Pakistan have fought many wars. Before that, there was partition. So there are historical reasons for all of that. But I have to say that, you know, this is some... I'm sorry, I can't see your face. This is something that can only be dealt with through a societal effort on both sides, which neither country is allowing. If visas were given to regular Indians and regular Pakistanis, I tell you the conversation would be very different. You know, when Manmohan Singh was Prime Minister, there was a film called Taj Mahal, made by Akbar Khan, Sanjay Khan's brother. And he approached Manmohan Singh, and Manmohan Singh said, what a brilliant idea, it should be seen across the border. And General Musharraf was the military dictator on our side then. But they talked, and that film was shown on both sides. So where there's a will, where there's good leadership, and this is exactly like today in Pakistan, the Supreme Court has declared Indian movies can't be shown. This is the first thing that politicians do, and that's what seeps into culture, is not letting us see each other. Whether it's through film or popular culture or music or from cross-border travel.
Can I add something to that? Because so three of my closest friends are Pakistani, and I haven't met two of them ever. And the other girl I've met twice, once when she came to Delhi and I flew from Madras to Delhi because she couldn't get a visa to visit me. And the other time we met in New York. And she was saying, if I moved to New York, maybe we could meet more often, you know. So, but when I'm in trouble, these three people are among those whom I turn to most often. And I think the internet has helped enormously. The fact that we are watching each other's films and each other's serials, even if the channels are banned in these countries, you can't stop the internet, you can't stop proxy websites from popping up when those websites are banned. You can't stop conversations on WhatsApp or Twitter or Facebook. And I think that is helping a lot. Because when I was growing up, there was this whole thing about if you were patriotic, you had to, or you would have children's games where, okay, this team was India and that team was Pakistan, or you'd be punished by being sent to Pakistan and all sorts of nonsense. Whereas now, even when it's so much harder to travel between the countries, it's much easier to have a conversation. I used to write for a Pakistani newspaper. I have friends who are from Pakistan who are writing for Indian newspapers. So I think that is something which will change over time naturally. And I think we have to constantly fight the rabid people who will want that to not happen. Because milne though doesn't have to be real. It can be virtual, right?
Ma'am. When the US election happened, a lot of people brush aside Trump by saying, with this homophobic, with this immigrant hatred, he won't win. And people were like, we won't vote for Trump. But eventually, people did vote for Trump and he did win. We can see the same thing in India, you know. There was a time when we were very secular. We never said in front, there was not openly hatred about like, oh, you're a Muslim, go to Pakistan and so. But we can see that now. I can see my friends who seem very secular, but now the narrative has changed. People are like openly saying that, oh, like the hatred or whatever it is. You think India was living in a pseudo secular world, and now we can actually see the real face? And it's for everyone, whoever wants to answer.
Yesterday we were having a conversation at dinner about how even someone was speaking about in Allahabad, which I will still call it Allahabad. Where there was this huge religious mela, and there were many trans women who are given positions of extreme importance, the Mahamandaleshwar, and Lakshmi Narayan Tripathi has gone on record saying, oh, we will build the Ram temple in Ayodhya. And we were speaking about how somebody who's from a marginalized community still can see herself as a majority which must oppress another minority. And we were speaking about the temptation to gravitate towards power structures. So even if somebody, so the fact that Trump or Modi or you know, the Le Pens in France or whoever, I mean, who are extreme right wing, still have popular support, part of the reason is that people want to see themselves as part of the majority, I think. So you will, if you're a gay white man who's worried about losing his job, do you support Trump or do you support Hillary or do you support Bernie Sanders? You know,
I'll just jump in on the US side. I knew Trump was going to win, and you know, it's terrible. But I will say, I think something like 60% of American Muslims voted for Trump. A huge amount of the American Hindu community voted for Trump. And you know why it was? It's the same reason why people voted for Modi. Check your checkbook, how much you earn, and for rich people, how little tax you pay. So underpinning, let's be very honest about this, underpinning all this hatred, these riots, all of this stuff, which sometimes, you know, the tap is on and sometimes suddenly the tap is shut off. Why is that? There are big economic players at work. And that was when we found out, I mean, the percentages of these minority communities, Hispanics, Mr. Build the Wall Trump, Hispanics were huge voters of his, not of the Democratic Party. So economy, money comes first, and it's often the unspoken reason. And then you use religion and you use all of these other biases to make your argument more emotional and therefore connect to more people.
I'll just take 2 minutes to answer not just this question, but the question that was previous, that how do we check this. I'll just give you an example. So 2017, during the Ramzan, I read there was the CSDS study that said that only 33% of Hindus in India consider a Muslim among their close friends. Only 33%. I found that an appalling figure, and I was like, what? But then I looked back. In my school, I was the only Muslim in my class. And I made friends with, what, 5, 10 people who came home? What about the others? There were 40 in a class. There are 30 others who never came to a Muslim house. Or maybe they had a Muslim neighbor, so maybe 20 of them. But that's still a large number who grew up not really going to a Muslim house, knowing about our culture. So maybe that is why it was so easy for them to buy into stereotypes that, you know, you're married three or thrice, you have three wives, and you have so many children, and all of them are illiterate, or you wear the burqa and you bang on doors, as our television keeps portraying Muslim women as. So I put out a Facebook post saying that if you have never been to an iftar, I'll call you over. I thought, you know, 3-4 people will say yes, I'll call them. Last checked, I had 90 comments on that post. I was like, oops. So, and I live in a flat. So, but thankfully, because of the book, I had, you know, had so many women who were, you know, part of my network. Somebody said, do you need help? I said, yes. Somebody said, I live in a bungalow, I can accommodate 100. I said, I have a venue. By the end of the week, I had 12 women who volunteered to cook. You know, I'll get biryani. Somebody said, I'll get kebabs. I'll get samosa. I'll get the chole. I had an iftar party ready. I had 100 strangers. Okay, these were like friends of friends of friends. You know how Facebook is. We are all connected. So who I'd never met and who traveled as far as 50 kilometers, Gurgaon to Noida. And during that week, we realized the kind of stereotypes that are there out there. You know, they said, can we wear certain colors? Can we wear certain kinds of clothes? Can we, you know, watch you pray? And in the beginning, everybody was so scared about where they are in a, you know, Muslim house. Then somebody said, thankfully, you all are here and can see we don't have swords on our walls. And that kind of, you know, broke the ice. But I realized by the end of the evening, we were all friends for life. And you can see, they were like, where are these Muslim women before? We have never seen them, you know, out. Why are you not out there talking like this? I said that maybe because people don't want to show us in a certain light. They don't want to see articulate, you know, out of those 12, there was a biker, there was a lawyer, there was a pilot, there were historians, there were writers, there were bloggers, entrepreneurs, all kinds of women, all shades of Muslim women. But we get to see certain shades that are more convenient for certain narratives to be formed. This year, in fact, we gave blank chits to paper. Then it kind of, you know, became a movement across India. We had 8 cities where women, you know, opened their doors and, you know, invited strangers in, cooked for them with a lot of love. Come see, you know, our culture, our food. We eat vegetarian also, FYI. So, and, you know, and we gave them blank chits and we asked them to write down one stereotype or prejudice you grew up hearing or believing. And I was appalled to see the kind of, so it was, you know, anonymous. You put it in a bowl, you mix it up and we read it out. Somebody wrote that, I grew up hearing that Muslims behead a goat and eat its flesh raw. I mean, you eat flesh raw. And I'm like, how do I address this? Somebody said that we heard that Muslims bathe a corpse and use that water and drink it. They're like, what? So these are the kind of conversations that are happening we are not even aware of. And from the majority, I can understand it's easy to not know about us. I mean, every year I get asked how many Eids, ye kaun si Eid hai, meethi Eid hai ki non-veg wali Eid hai, which Eid is this? People still every year need to ask us, is this the sweet Eid or is this when we get non-veg? As a minority, I grew up between, you know, surrounded by Holi, Diwali. I will never ask you what's the difference between Holi and Diwali. We all know it. It's we celebrate it, we all know it. But from the majoritarian perspective, I can understand it takes that little bit of extra effort to reach out. So maybe we just, you know, the onus is not on the minority only to reach out. The onus is on both sides. And I guess that is the way forward for India. Reach out.
Thank you. Yeah, I think there were some more questions, but we've been asked to wrap up. So I want to thank all three of my panelists. I think it's a discussion that can go on for a much longer time because there are many dimensions of it. But certainly I hope it has given all of us some food for thought to think ahead of how we stop othering and how we really create the kind of nations that we want to live in. Thank you.
Thank you so much.